between the 2nd of April, 1888, and September the 17th, 1889, a dreadful fear descended over the streets of London. No one who saw that face lived, except one small child whom he spared, because she was his own flesh and blood.
There was another murder. They're looking for Jack the Ripper. It's you.
The records tell us that the Ripper killed 9 times. The curse lived on into a second generation of terror.
Damn it, Pritchard, you've got to possess being in your home as savage as any wild beast.
These are the streets. And these are the women. And this is the girl who inherited the hands that Jack used.
What's happening, everyone? This is Michael yet again, and thank you all for joining me once again here on YouTube. Well, everyone, this continues to be a month of horror. That's right, celebrating horror films all the month of October. And this is a very special October to me, as I will be looking at films from the legendary UK studio Hammer Pictures. All films, all Hammer, this month in October. Now, before I begin, one of the questions that I get from a few people from the UK, and I can't believe I haven't answered this question already, but the question I get is, aside from Hammer, do I like any other UK properties? And if you've been a fan of the channel and subscribed and followed me for a while, you probably already know the answer to that question. But although I haven't seen a whole lot of British television, I do have a couple of more favorites that I just immensely love. The first being Doctor Who. I absolutely love Doctor Who. And as far as my favorite Doctor, it is the legendary Tom Baker. I love Tom Baker. He's always been my favorite Doctor Who. I still love him to this day. And he was my introduction to Doctor Who. And I can't even begin to stress the limits of my love for this actor and this character. Tom Baker is my ultimate Doctor Who actor. And God, guys, love this guy. Love him to death. And, you know, I don't know for sure, but Tom Baker, has he been knighted yet? Is he Sir Tom Baker? Because if he isn't, he sure in the hell should be by now. Remarkable man. Remarkable human being. Just love this guy. And second, another British actor that I love equally and have always loved from the very first time I saw this guy on television when I was a kid, but love him to this day, still love him. That's the mark of a great actor or comedian or entertainer, is that, you know, your love for these people never go away. It just always stays. And in many cases, it even gets stronger. But, you know, it would have to be Benny Hill. Oh, my goodness gracious. Benny Hill. Absolutely adore Benny Hill. And, you know, one of the saddest days of my life is when Benny Hill passed away. I just felt so moved by that. It was just, what a terrible day that was. But Benny Hill, a great comedian. I mean, you have, you know, people up there, Laurel and Hardy. You have the Three Stooges. You have all these great comedians. And then you have Benny Hill, who takes his place up there. I absolutely, as I said, adore Benny Hill. And to this day, guys, Benny Hill is still a comedian that I watch, I would say, at least once a week. You know, I'll go and watch a clip on YouTube, or I have the complete set of Benny Hill's episodes, and I just absolutely love Benny Hill. Benny Hill, Tom Baker, and of course the Hammer horror films. Just, I just, God, guys, you just don't know how much I adore these things. And I'm sure there's many more out there for me to get into, but as of now, yeah, those are my favorites. Now, moving on, everybody. Moving on to the next film. Now, I had posted on the community page, you know, I took a picture of myself, you know, lying in the floor, reading up on Marcus Hearn's book about the Hammer films and choosing my next Hammer film. And I asked a question of if anybody could guess from the little picture that was on the page, could you guess what movie I was going to be giving my thoughts on next? Now, a lot of you said movies that I've already talked about. So that was kind of funny because, the National Alert. This is a test of the National Wireless Emergency Alert System. Well, there you have it. The big alert we've been hearing about, everybody. Will I leave that in the recording? I don't know. But anyway, guys, no one could guess the next film that I was going to talk about. And you know what? I'm going to show you a picture of the picture in the book that I was looking at the time I posted that picture. I think I still got it nearby. All right, everybody. Here's the picture here. This is a picture from Hands of the Ripper. This is the film that I'm going to be giving my thoughts on today. And I know it's a lot of glare there and it's kind of hard to see. But yeah, this is the character, the doctor, lying on the floor in a church and he's dying. But Hands of the Ripper is the next film that I'm going to get my thoughts on. And some of you have asked, what book do I get this information from? Well, it's very simple. This is called The Hammer Story, and it's put out by Marcus Hearns and Alan Barnes. And this is a great book. Sir Christopher Lee on the cover. And I usually take the slip cover off when I look at this, but once it's off, you have Sir Peter Cushing. And this is a great book. And on the back, Christopher Lee. Looks like From the Devil Rides Out. I could be wrong, but that's what it looks like. And it's a great book, guys. It's a great book. Great pages, you know. Some of them in color, some of them in black and white. But the important thing is that there's a shit ton of information here about these classic films. And it's, you know, if you're a Hammer fan, I got to recommend that this is most certainly a book that you should have in your collection, because it's just totally epic. But yeah, great book. I love it. And I get a lot of information from this book. And aside from that, I also, you know, sometimes tread the internet and get some information from some reputable sites. But, you know, even with that, sometimes you do get details wrong. It happens. But, you know, you just do the best you can. But anyway. All right. Here we have the network version of Hands of the Ripper. And this is one that I had never seen up until a few days ago. And this is, like I said, the network version of the movie. And it's a pretty nice collection here. It has some nice special features in it that you can't see because of the glare. But it has some nice special features. It has a commentary by two gentlemen and the actress who actually plays Anna, Jack the Ripper's daughter in the film. And all I'll say about the commentary is that it does get a little bit off track sometimes. They do kind of indulge in things that aren't necessarily about the film that I feel like, you know, they could have kept out of the commentary and focused more on the movie, more on the experience with the actors, and so on and so forth. But I would say out of all the commentaries that I've listened to on the Hammer films, I would say so far the one for Hands of the Ripper is probably the weakest. But aside from that, it is a nice Blu-ray. It's a nice collection of the film. And most certainly, I would say, you know, it's the one that you should own because it does have making of materials on here. Not a whole bunch, but it does have some. Hands of the Ripper was released October 3rd, 1971, and it was directed by a gentleman named Peter Sasdy. Now, Sasdy was no stranger to Hammer horror films, as he had directed two films previously for the studio, those films being Taste the Blood of Dracula and Countess Dracula. Now, Sasdy was recruited to direct the film by producer Aida Young. And being released in the 70s, this was a very difficult time for Hammer. They were trying to adjust and change to a very overcrowded scheme of other production companies doing bolder things in film and making their mark in the world. Now, one of the things I noticed about this movie when I was watching it is the fact that there were times when I found myself missing the golden years of Hammer films, the charm, the magic that kind of went into these films that made them stand out. And that's not to say that any of the films or all of the films from the 70s did not possess their own special kind of charm or uniqueness. But I found myself missing the production design of Bernard Robinson, or perhaps the photography of Jack Asher, missing James Bernard's music, the direction of Terrence Fisher. I found myself watching this film, and at the same time, I kind of developed a longing for the magic of those older films. And I guess, you know, most of the time when I watch a Hammer film, I watch films that are from the formative years of the studio, the golden years is what I would call them. So when I switch up to the 70s, there's a very distinct difference in the style in those films if you compare them to the earlier films, where Hammer was this trailblazing company that was raising the bar and teaching all these other studios what horror really was. So yeah, I found myself, you know, and it was kind of weird because that's never happened to me before when I watched any of these films, that I felt a longing for the older films. And I don't know if it's because I just watched The Mummy, and that's really a bold film. But I did find myself feeling that way at the time of watching this movie. Hands of the Ripper went into production almost simultaneously with another Hammer horror classic film, that film being Dr. Jekyll and Sister Hyde. And I have given my thoughts on this film here on the channel, and it's a film that I do enjoy. Now, from the very start of production, producer Aida Young and director Peter Sasdy wanted British television star Eric Porter to star in the film. And Porter had worked with Hammer a few years earlier on a film called The Lost Continent. But despite this, Hammer was dead set against it. They did not feel that Porter had the star power or the appeal to actually bring audiences in to see the movie. And Peter Sasdy would not have this because he went behind Hammer's back and hired him anyway. And his attitude was more or less, I don't care what they say, I'm hiring who I want to hire for the role. So that's how we got Eric Porter as the star. It would be producer Aida Young who would cast a young 23-year-old woman in the role of Anna, Jack the Ripper's daughter, as played by Angerod Rees. Now, when Rees was given the script, she decided to take it home to her father, who was an actual clinical psychologist. And she felt like, after reading the script, that her father would be able to explain the psyche of this character. Thus, this would aid her in portraying this character. So her father helped her and determined that this character was indeed suffering from some deeply seated psychosis. He explained it to her. And once this was done, she felt like she had a deeper understanding of the character. And she felt like in everyday life, this character was simply a normal person suffering from mental disease. And she felt like this really aided her in understanding this character and also playing this character. One of the distinctions this film holds is the fact that it is seen by many fans of Hammer and even historians in that it is one of the most violent films Hammer has ever made. And when it was released in the United States, the MPAA had cuts, trims of two of the deaths in particular, the death of Dolly and Long Liz. Now, I would agree that it is a pretty violent film in terms of the brutality that the daughter of Jack the Ripper uses to slay her victims. And this was a thing for films of the 70s. Hammer was trying to outdo some of the other filmmakers, some of the other competition, where these types of things were seen quite a bit in the 70s, where violence was used to draw people in. Going back to director Peter Sasdy and the fact that this would be his final film for Hammer, Sasdy rose to prominence by his work on the show The Caves of Steel. This was an adaptation of a story by Isaac Asimov, and it played on BBC Two's Story Parade series. And it was very popular. And believe it or not, on that series, Sasdy would meet Peter Cushing as he starred in that series. It would be his work on the BBC anthology series Journey to the Unknown that would inspire producer Aida Young to recruit and approach him to direct Hammer's film Taste the Blood of Dracula. And during the 80s, Sasdy became known for his work on Hammer's House of Horror and Hammer's House of Mystery and Suspense. Those that worked with him would say he was quite the perfectionist, and in being that way, he didn't often get along too well with the other people behind the scenes, as they felt that he was really demanding for perfection in his work. But unfortunately, perfection is something that is rarely achieved in filmmaking or in anything that we do in life. So that put him at odds with many of the people behind the scenes. Now, despite there being quite a few women of the night in this film, lots of prostitutes, or as the film refers to them, whores, there's really no nudity in terms of what we see with the prostitutes in the movie. Now, that's not so the case with Angerad Rees, who actually, when she signed on to this film, she signed on to do no nudity. However, the first day of the shoot, she discovered that the producers wanted her to do a nude scene. And this consisted of her being in a bathtub and being covered by water and suds and all that. But she would be sitting in the tub and her breasts and nipples would be in view. Now, she had her hands over her bosom, but in certain shots, you could see her nipples. And she was really upset about this. She didn't sign on for this. As a matter of fact, she signed to not do any nudity. And to show up for the first day of shooting and discover that the producers want you to do nudity, show your breasts and nipples. Well, this she did the scene, but she was very upset about it. And to this day, if you listen to the commentary, you can tell that she did not really agree that that was the right thing or the right situation to put her in, being this young 23-year-old girl and having to do this scene when she was told there would be no nudity. What I will say in retrospect, of course, is that, you know, being this young girl who, you know, is obviously very excited to be in a film for the first time, all that pressure kind of leaned on her and probably gave her the mindset that, yeah, maybe I should do this, because if I don't do this, I won't be able to appear in this film. And honestly, everyone, I think that's pretty that's a pretty bad situation to put this young lady in. And if they promised her no nudity, they probably should not have done any nudity. Now, with that said, I will say that the scene is a very modest scene. It's not a close-up or anything like that. I mean, we see the sides of her nipples in the film. And maybe it might even just be one shot where we see one nipple. But going from being this stage play actress to actually, you know, in your first feature film, actually showing that much skin, that had to be a really difficult situation for her to be in. And probably pretty wrong of the producers and the director to allow her to be pressured into doing that scene. The production ran into a problem when it came time to shoot the climax of the film, which was scripted to take place at St. Paul's Cathedral. Now, producer Aida Young was unable to gain permission to film on location in the church, and they forbade any kind of camera crews inside the church due to the subject matter of the film. So what she ended up doing was taking about a dozen still images inside the church and then giving these images to the special effects people. They built partial sets and then used blue screen to insert the actors in the still images alongside the actual practical sets. This worked, and it probably saved quite a bit of money too as well. However, when you look at the finished film, you can see that the still images do indeed stand out against the blue screen. But, you know, Hammer got the shots it needed, got the film completed, and basically that's all that mattered. Hands of the Ripper was released alongside Twins of Evil, but unfortunately critics were not kind to the film, and as a matter of fact, they pretty much classified it as a well-made, well-acted melodrama that was uninspired and generic. So the film did not fare well in the UK, and furthermore, across the pond in the United States, the film received a bit of better reviews, but unfortunately it was not a hit in the US as well. So it pretty much faded in obscurity, and it was pretty much also outclassed by other exploitative films that just pushed the bar a bit more than Hammer was willing to go at the time. Hands of the Ripper. How did I feel about this movie? I will say that I can understand where the critics were coming from when they initially reviewed this film and how they felt like it was lackluster, how they felt like the violence was there, but basically the story didn't match the visceral violence in the movie, and that it felt like a pretty standard movie in terms of what Hammer had done in the past. I get that. I really do. And on that note, I would have to agree with them. I mean, the film raises some really great questions, with the number one question being, why do human beings kill each other? And when I heard Eric Porter's character ask that question, I really kind of thought, since I had never seen the film before, that we were in for some kind of journey into the psyche of why human beings kill each other. Now, of course, I didn't expect the film to answer that question, but I thought that the film would at least make an attempt to answer that question. And they never did. And that was a disappointment, because with such a brilliant question asked, I thought at the very least the film should have addressed that question and tried to solve it with some answer, but it never happened. And that was disappointing. And another thing about this film is that I'm not meaning to down Eric Porter as an actor, because he's obviously a very capable actor. But I felt like this film needed an actor with more gravitas. And I can understand why perhaps they didn't want to cast Peter Cushing in the part, because this character was very, very similar to Baron von Frankenstein. But, you know, when you think about Baron von Frankenstein, you think about how he was driven, how when he was on screen, he totally took up the entire attention of the film when he was on screen. And Eric Porter's character just did not have that screen presence. And that takes me back to Hammer's initial thoughts when it came to casting for the role, and how they thought that Eric Porter was not the right actor. And, you know, they could have been correct, because he most certainly, and like I said, not to down him as an actor, because I'm pretty damn sure that he's probably good, a really good actor, but he may have been miscast in this. He was a very brooding actor in this. And I kind of felt like he really didn't pull me in to the story. And I don't know if that was because of him as an actor or the story itself. But when you have this great question of, you know, why do we kill each other? And you never answer this question, and all you have is a psychotic girl killing people, you know, there's just not a whole lot there. And so when I say I can understand how the critics felt at the time, then they probably felt like I do now, that the film asked a brilliant question and was just never followed up. So instead, all we got was death scenes, and that was disappointing. Now, what I will say about this film that really kind of shook me was the beginning, and I didn't expect this because, you know, horror films are made to horrify, to terrify. And the opening scenes with Jack the Ripper killing his wife while the little kid watches, that was just brutal to me. You know, that child watching her mother be killed, stabbed to death, that was probably more brutal to me than all the other kills in the movie. Because you just think, you know, wow, that kid's watching this right in front of her eyes. And it was just, it was brutal, just totally brutal. And that those scenes were really hard to take. And as I said, guys, you know, the film itself, it has a brilliant premise with this doctor willing to allow anything to discover why people kill each other. But you get to a point where, you know, you want to sympathize with this doctor, Dr. Pritchard. You want to care about this guy. But when you find out that he's willing to allow anyone to die in order to prove or discover why people kill each other, you kind of lose a lot of connection with this guy, and you kind of think you just don't give a damn about him because he doesn't give a damn about anybody else. And that's how I ended up feeling about him, because he was willing to let not only, you know, his housekeeper and the people that ran the house around him die so that he could learn something about death and suffering, but he was also willing to let his own flesh and blood son die. That was that was a really hard thing to accept in terms of, you know, connecting me to this character, because, you know, at first I thought he was perhaps maybe honorable in that, you know, we opened the film with a scene of a girl being forced upon by another guy, and he reacts, he doesn't like it, and then as the film progresses, he turns into this guy that's willing to allow anybody to die so that he basically can set up some kind of science experiment and learn about the passions of murder, why we do it, and all this kind of stuff. So, yeah, he wasn't very likable as a character. And the one thing that was kind of interesting to me is that, you know, whenever he would discover somebody died or had been brutally killed, he would have this look on his face of disgust, like he just, you know, he's just horrified by it. But at the same time, you think you're willing to let this happen to your closest family and friends, and you don't care. So why are you acting all horrified and terrified when you find someone's been brutally murdered? So I think that at the end of the day, if we had had a stronger lead character, and I want to lean toward Peter Cushing, I think that he would have brought more gravitas and more life to this character. Because, you know, at the end of the day, when you watch Peter Cushing in a role or in the role of Baron von Frankenstein, you almost have a like to this character in that you know that he has a passion for what he's doing. And you know that he's blinded by his desires to actually, you know, he's going about it the wrong way and trying to help mankind, but you know that's what's driving him. And Eric Porter as Pritchard, you never really get that passion as a character that you got with Peter Cushing. And perhaps it's unfair to compare the two, but I mean, you know, it's a role similar to roles that Peter Cushing had played. Despite the film asking these really relevant questions, we don't have an actor to actually have the passion to bring life to this story. Now, what I'll also say, too, is that the acting, the sets, like the critics said at the time, all A+. Great job. Even the score is a decent score. And you think about the inner messages in this film, and I talked about questions that this film asks. The question of whether or not we as parents are responsible for what happens to our children. Because you have this underlying kind of message in that, you know, we are to blame for how our children turn out. Anna, a very tragic character. She didn't ask what happened to her. I mean, the girls watched her mother be murdered. Then she was taken in, more or less, by this lady who ran a brothel, who attempted to prostitute her out. And then she was so mixed up that she became a murderer. And the film doesn't say whether or not she's actually possessed by her father or she's recalling memories of what happened that day and she's hearing her father's voice. And that's fine, too, because I don't really think it's necessary to know either way. But the film does ask some really interesting questions about whether or not or the ramifications of our effects on our children, on the next generation, how our actions are translated to them. And, you know, it hits into several things today, how we may see sexual predators in the world, who these people, many of them were molested as children. And you think about the ramifications of, you know, yeah, this guy was sexually molested, abused physically, mentally, and he grows up and he becomes this this person that we in society may deem a monster. But we're short-sighted in the fact that, you know, these were once small children mistreated badly, betrayed by, in many cases, their parents. And then they grow up and they try to function in a world that they pretty much don't have a chance in. So the film does raise some important questions, and it certainly gives you food for thought, but it's just so unfortunate that the movie went to just being a straight slasher film where people are dying and there's just no substance to the story. And perhaps if Eric Porter had been given more substance and more things to do and actually act on his psychology and delved into why people do this, I think it would have been a much more interesting story. But, you know, I tend to think of these Hammer films as fine wine. They seem to age gracefully and they get better, because it's most certainly not a film that I hated. Far from it. I did enjoy the film, but, you know, I'm pretty much taken by the Hammer movies, and I've yet to see a Hammer film that I just did not like. But there's always something in these movies to me to enjoy. But, you know, ultimately, I think that the story itself let the actors and the film down. I think it should have delved deeper. I think it should have been bolder. And I think it should have answered, or at least attempted to answer, some questions. Great performances, great score, great production design. Pretty pedestrian in terms of what goes on in the story. So, anyway, there you have it, everybody. Thank you all for watching. Take care of yourselves and be safe.